Ladies and gentlemen, I want to say hello. Today is our presentation on practical Bitcoin. I've just spent the last 5 minutes creating an email account on protonmail.com.
Good choice. And,
pardon?
Good choice.
And our main speaker has just, our main speaker is Mike Seiler, but right now all I've done is set up a Bitcoin Coinbase account, I think.
Don't worry about it. Yes.
And what's on the screen, what you're seeing right now is coinbase.com. And who wants to talk next? Right. I think right. It's...
So now you've got an account, Rob.
Okay, hold all on right. One second. Let's make sure that... Could you get that microphone closer to you? Thank you.
Okay, so now Ralph has an account. He got an email address. He went to sign up, and Coinbase called him back on his cell phone to verify he was. So now they got you. You know, he's got your cell phone address, and that's how they track all this stuff. So signing up with Coinbase is just like signing up with your local bank.
They have definite know your customer laws.
They've got the know your customer laws, and 14,000 of them. Just they had to release the information on 14,000 accounts that used $20,000 or more in 2015 and 2016. Or 2014 and 2015. I may have the years wrong. I hope it was 2014 and 2015 because I was just getting started and I would have hit the threshold. But a judge in California just ruled that IRS had to give them all this information. So there are 14,000 people that the IRS is looking at that spent $20,000. So anything you do with Coinbase, you got to be all on the up and up. And it's just as if the IRS is right over your shoulder. So go back to your screen there, Ralph, and hit buy and sell.
Buy and sell, okay.
Because all you can do is buy. Are you putting your screen up?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I had that ready.
I can make faces while you do that. Oh, you have to add a payment method. Oh, too bad. All right.
So by adding a payment method, that's a credit card of some
sort? Credit card is enough for now.
But I'd rather not
do that in front of all of us.
Right.
Anyway, so you get to this stage, and I was hoping you'd be able to actually see a buy-sell window there. You do see the buy and sell. If he had had a payment method, he could have put that in, and then he would have seen the choices that were available for buying. And I think it's Bitcoin, Ethernet, Bitcoin Cash, I understand,
yes,
is in there now.
And Litecoin.
And Litecoin. So you got four choices of how to get in the world of crypto. So I will stop now and turn this over to the real speaker. But this is the intro. You add your payment method, and then you can buy one of those four crypto coins, and it's just like doing a transaction at your bank. You've got your credit card, they've got your cell phone number, everything has to be on the up and up.
Okay.
Well, what do you mean on the up and up as far as
April 15
taxes are concerned?
Money.
Do you need to declare something on your taxes or something?
Yes. Do I need to declare something on my taxes? I tied with my Coinbase account to a debit card. And I have to use that debit card every 6 months. So I bought dinner with my little Shift debit card the other day, and I spent $39.50. And I'm going to have to record my purchase price and the sales price as of when this transaction happened, because I bought my Bitcoin at around $900, and I spent whatever fraction that was at when the Bitcoin was at 16,000.
Wow.
So I'm going to have a long-term capital gains of the price of that one fraction of a hundredth of a Bitcoin on the day I bought it in 2015, and that $39.50 that I spent in US dollars. So yes, the accounting's a nightmare.
Well, yeah. What if you don't spend any? What if you just let it sit there?
then you don't have to do anything. Buying a property or owning a property does not incur a tax liability.
Oh, okay.
It's only when you, and I, they, the IRS claims if you change it from Bitcoin into any other coin by going to an exchange, that that's also a taxable event and you have to record it. That hasn't been proven in court.
Uh-huh.
There's a lot of people that, maybe it's wishful thinking, think they don't have to have a tax liability until they've converted it to a currency, like dollars or some sort of fiat. So, yeah, the accounting's a nightmare. I went and got my business accounting system for first in, first out, and hopefully that'll keep me honest.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm done.
Give it to the real speakers.
All right. Let me get this mic in front of Mike.
Mike.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to be yelling because the microphone is at the other end of the table. Our two speakers, three speakers today, I'd like to introduce the man who's with the hat is Mike Seiler.
Thank you.
To his left is Lance Psycho, although that's not how he's spelled. And the person that was speaking previously was Bill Gibson, who is off camera, sort of off camera. And he's our treasurer, he's our beloved treasurer, because without him, this organization would not exist. So, Mike, you are up.
All right.
And what we can do is we can get the various websites up on the screen if you want.
Yes, so what do I plug in, where, and how?
You don't plug in anything. I will get to the website for you.
Ah, okay. All right. Okay.
So what website would you like me to go to?
Let's see. Let's start with cryptocompare.com.
Ooh.
Cryptocompare.com.
I think that's the...
Let's see if that gets us to the right place.
Nope. Okay.
No, I spelled it wrong.
Okay. Website that lets you compare cryptocurrency wallets is what I'm after. And the one that Google likes to bring up is one that I thought was called cryptocompare.com/wallet.
It should have came up.
It's got WW8 for whatever reason. Where's my home key? There it is. And
Anyway, while we're working on
not
that.
Yet. Do you want me to put in it slash wallet? And
yeah.
I'm waiting for it to come up. Is it coming up?
Good. Yes. Okay. We'll leave it there for now.
Great.
We'll put the wallet. Cryptocurrencies are changing, the whole field is changing rapidly at the moment. So I'd like to say that what I'm going to say now today is going to be valuable 6 months, a year from now, possibly not so much. But I did want to make this very much a practical, hands-on kind of thing. So if everybody will just give me like 10 seconds about what it is they hope to learn today, I'll see if I can work that in. So,
Marty, you're up. And just speak up loudly so we can record you. Marty, why are you here?
I just want to learn how to invest.
Yell.
Invest? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes?
I'm here with this guy. He's the one that's involved.
Okay,
so
this guy?
This is my boyfriend, Kevin.
Yeah, so I've been involved with this for a little while now, but I'm just want to see other people's ideas and what they think and how they like this.
Okay, exchange ideas. Okay.
General information.
Okay. Ideas.
Me too.
Heidi.
She mentioned wanting to know how to invest. I would say I want to know how to spend
it.
Okay. All right. Larry.
Ditto.
It's okay. I'll get that one for
you.
Okay.
Well, I was hoping to help anybody, but yeah. It's such a giant market that I'm sure I'm going to learn something. I've never been to Crypto Compare, so I've already learned something new.
Okay.
General.
Okay.
Decentralized exchanges.
Okay.
I know a fair bunch.
But I'm like, just exchange ideas, visualize. Yeah.
There's one
behind.
Off. Yes.
Because
I came out knowing I'd come to this. At least I learned something new with that email.
Okay. Anybody else off camera?
I'd like to know more about the political implications of having decentralized digital currency. The person who formed Bitcoin was a dedicated crypto anarchist, and I think it is starting to have an impact on how people think about money.
Okay, Ken, today's lecture is practical Bitcoin, so we're going to stay away from the politics and talk about what it takes to actually do this stuff. Okay, Michael?
Yes. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay. Anybody else? Good. Okay. I think where I will start is exactly where Ralph has already started, is getting a Bitcoin wallet, because in order to do anything at all, or actually cryptocurrency wallet, you need to actually have the wallet, then you need to fund it, and then depending on what you want to do, it goes on from there. So, Ralph, you now have a CoinDesk wallet?
I have a Coinbase something.
Excuse me, Coinbase account. Okay, Coinbase account, that's what I meant.
Okay, and I don't know that I've actually completed everything. It's asking for my phone number.
Uh-huh.
And, let's just talk. I mean, I don't want to display my phone number on this video.
Yeah.
Let's just talk about what it takes. I mean, what steps you have to go through.
Right. Does anybody today here now want to set up another wallet just like Ralph started to do? Except I'm going to suggest putting one on your phone or Well, in Bill's case, a laptop, but I'm sure he's already taken care of that.
I have a paper wallet on my that's somewhere.
Okay.
And a Trezor.
Oh,
so I did bring a Trezor.
It's at mobile, all right? Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. Anybody else specifically want to set up a wallet?
Well, I can continue to set up this wallet and...
No, let's do something. Let's switch gears and put you on a different wallet, one that's on your system there, and then we'll put something in it as part of the demonstration today.
I have no idea what you just said, but walk me through it.
Okay. So in Crypto Compare...
Okay, I'm going back to Crypto Compare.
Okay. And I believe it is / wallet is where I want to go next.
It's not like me today.
Oh, okay.
Hey, did I spell wallet wrong?
No. I'm probably not remembering it quite right. See if there, someplace on Crypto Compare, there's a place for you to look up wallets.
Crypto Compare is running slowly.
Yeah, that's they're probably keeping pretty busy. It's wallets with an S.
Okay.
Hi.
We're
actually going to talk about the dog coin or Dogecoin in just a moment, so it's a good question. We'll get to that. Okay, so that's it. Okay, so just for the sake of illustration, Ralph, go ahead and page down there so people can see how long the list of choices are. There's columns there with various kinds of attributes of the wallet. The point is that there's a lot of wallets. Depending on specifically what you're trying to accomplish, you may want to choose one wallet over another. The Electrum is a really popular wallet. The first one a little bit further down is a Mycelium, which is one that I like using. But what we're going to do is go ahead and go down to one called Jax, J-A-X-X, Valve.
Trying to find it.
It's down a ways. least it was down a ways when when I was looking at this. You can just probably maybe do search. Oh, I see. It's continuing on. It just took it a while to load the page. Okay.
Yeah, I think they don't do it in alphabetical order, so you get a.
Well, there is a filter on the upper right where you can set it for your particular operating system.
Should I go look for Jacks?
Yeah, you should be almost there. So, for example, this will tell you that this here is for Android, for Linux. I don't know what that symbol is, but anyway, it's symbols for the different kinds of
Jacks.
Yep.
Okay, so what are we doing here?
Okay, let's see. Somewhere on there is go to wallet. Maybe you can just click on the Jack's wallet or the okay. More. Okay. However we get there. Okay. Okay. And on the right there is wallet website. Go ahead and click on that. Okay. Go ahead and click download now. Now. Yesterday, like I said, it's a rapidly changing field. I looked at a number of the wallets, and the reason why I selected this one is because it has rather intriguing feature in that you can not just buy Bitcoin, but you can exchange Bitcoin for other cryptocurrencies. And this wallet allows you to have other cryptocurrencies in the same user interface in the same wallet. Is that downloading? Press the download button.
Okay, let me try the download again.
Okay.
Mike, you said you can have multiple currencies in the same wallet?
In this particular wallet, the Jax, J-A-X-X wallet.
Okay.
Specifically, you can take Bitcoin and buy a Dogecoin or Ethereum or Zcash. For some reason, Monero was missing. Not sure why, but there's at least half a dozen different currencies. Actually, more like a dozen that
okay,
you can.
Okay, I'm about to install the Jax setup.
Okay, good.
Here it goes.
It takes a few seconds to download. Okay.
I've heard good things about the Jax line.
Okay, it's doing something. I think. Okay, let me move this from a different screen to what our viewers can see. And come on.
Well, they brought up the release notes.
Okay, just press continue in the lower right.
I can find it.
It just slid off the bottom of the screen. Just
okay.
A tiny bit further. Yeah, there we
go.
Continue. Yes. Okay, go ahead and press accept. Now, what's cool about that is they do not want any personally identifiable information. Now, of course, they may or may not log the IP address. I
don't care if they log this one.
Yeah. It is possible to get a IP address from any place in the world, something called a proxy server, which you can buy in Bitcoin, by the way, and it's just a few dollars a month, and therefore you can appear to be any place in the world. Which, for the sake of investing, by the way, there's all kinds of laws in the United States about investing, but many parts of the world, there aren't those restrictions. So if you want to be free of those restrictions, you want to have an IP address that is not in the United States, and like I said, for a couple of bucks, you can get a proxy server in whatever country you want to be in.
Okay, do I create a new wallet at this point?
Yes.
Okay. It does not wish to maximize.
Just press continue.
Bottom right. Yep.
Yes.
Okay, just express is fine. Continue.
Yes.
Okay, now go ahead and click a bunch of these. Like I said, this wallet is kind of unique and especially cool in that you can have multiple cryptocurrencies and quickly and easily change between them. So go ahead and press click Bitcoin, Ethereum, Ethereum Classic, Litecoin, all the first ones down through Doge or Dog.
Click
and actually I have Bitcoin Cash too. Okay, and take me to my wallet.
So I can see the screen.
Okay, good. There it is, a wallet. Go ahead and go and on the upper, on the right. Excuse me, upper left. Little further over. You have a left and right arrow. The upper. Yep. There. Okay. Go to the one that says dog, or Doge. And so let me talk a little bit about Dogecoin. Dogecoin is kind of interesting in that it was based on the Bitcoin protocol, but it was considered kind of a joke, a lark, and so it's kind of just for fun, for giving somebody a tiny tip or whatever initially. Interesting enough, this month it has gone up 4 times, at least as for the last time I checked. And even a fun lock currency is increasing value. The reason I'm focusing on this as opposed to Bitcoin for the purpose of this demonstration is that with Bitcoin, moving Bitcoin from one account to one wallet to another costs about $25. With the Dogecoin, it's still a absolutely minuscule, trivial amount. So rather than burn $25 to illustrate what I'm going to do next, I'm going to use Dogecoin. The concept is the same, especially in this wallet. Let me go ahead and press receive wealth. Okay. Let's see. I guess press generate. I'm not quite sure how we do the receive, because I haven't done that.
And could I ask you to speak up instead of...
Yes, press the generate button, and let's see if that, okay. Oh, okay, I think what I need to do is send, okay.
Of his address.
Okay.
And send to him.
Well, let me see if I can just set this up.
Oh, beautiful. Thank you.
Well, it leads. Okay. Unfortunately, my Android phone tablet is not letting the camera work. But let me try it from over here. These are the kind of glitches that you have. The problem is that this address, which you can't really see, is every Bitcoin wallet has a long string, alphanumeric string. And that alphanumeric string is just kind of random and difficult to actually do anything to type in. And but if necessary, we can do that.
Can you just take a picture of the...
With this tablet will not let me do right now, but maybe I can do that for my laptop.
Ralph, what happens when you click receive?
Okay, let's try clicking receive.
Okay. You just need this. Let's see if that's right. Hey, Mike, isn't this
yes.
The address right here?
Yeah, I think it is. And
can you just copy it and quickly email it to you, and then you copy paste?
Go ahead and take
so
that
we'll
address
yep.
and email
perfect.
It to me.
And then that's your receiving
Wait,
address.
I don't think you got it all, Ralph.
No, I copied
it to
the clipboard.
He did.
Don't
think he clicked that.
Oh, okay.
He got it.
Never mind. Shut up, Bill.
Okay, now I have to figure out how to get this to you. So
okay, go ahead and... go ahead and... and
email
like
it
said, email.
To you. Oh, Lord. Hold on a sec. This is going to take me a bit.
Oh, okay.
So, I have a question. So, why use the wallet instead of just leaving it in Coinbase?
There you go.
Excuse me?
Great question.
Why use this instead of just leaving it in Coinbase?
Coinbase, I'm not sure, it lets you use Dogecoin. Well, the main reason I like this wallet actually is because he just set it up and he didn't have to give his email address, he didn't have to do anything, which from a libertarian perspective is, you know, less oversight is better kind of thing. So this
can
here...
Can you use US dollars to buy
I'm not sure you can buy, but you can trade between various kinds of Bitcoin.
So you need to come out of an exchange anyway. So why, if my exchange already has a wallet, why do I need to set up another wallet?
I'll answer this question.
Yes.
So the question is, why should you take,
yes, please.
Why should you take any kind of cryptocurrency off of an exchange? I'll give you an anecdotal answer here. And that is, my wife just got burned $2,000 because she didn't listen to me and left some of her cryptocurrency on Bittrex. Bittrex has been notorious for just closing accounts, or, you know, quote unquote closing accounts because of X, Y, and Z. Maybe there's a verification thing. I think they're just stealing cryptocurrency from people. So there's that risk of leaving it on an exchange of these. It's, you know, it's a very, this is a very fringy thing, that's this crypto, the whole cryptocurrency movement. And so there's a lot of fringy people associated with it, right?
There's a lot of criminals trying to figure out exactly how you steal somebody else's Bitcoin.
Exactly. The second reason would be, is because of hackers. So we actually think that she got hacked because she got phished through Bittrex in a phishing email and then responded not like a smart person and then, you know, lost her money, right? And then the third reason is, at any point, the government can just step in and say, we're done with these websites, and all of a sudden an FBI logo will pop up.
And I've seen that happen too.
Me too. I tried to, I can't remember which one I tried to get on.
BTC-E.
Yes.
Yeah.
I tried to get on that one about a month ago or something, and that popped up. So
yep.
The safest, it's just like, in my opinion, like US dollars, right? Sure, we keep our USD in bank accounts, but every, you know, there's a statistic out there that says 92% of it is actually just zeros and ones. So if a hacker comes in and wipes all that out, well, then we're all without fiat currency, right? So, I mean, the safest way to do this is you put it on a wallet, and ideally it should be a hard wallet, a cold storage wallet, or a paper wallet, like Bill mentioned, safely stored away somewhere.
Oh, I got one more. Everything I had on Coinbase, when the split happened on August 1st, I didn't get it. There's rumors that I can now finally, here it is, almost the end of 2017, that I can claim my split.
The split specifically is for Bitcoin Cash.
And also Bitcoin Gold happened again. There's another split. Bitcoin Diamond has also happened.
Yep.
Now,
2X.
So anything you have in the exchange, they own what you, they own your account, just like a bank. You don't have money in a bank. You just have a piece of paper that says the bank owes you money.
It's a third party.
It's their money. Same with the exchange. It's not your Bitcoin if you're not holding it. And that way you don't get the benefits like the splits. I'll never get my Bitcoin Gold or Bitcoin Diamond from the Bitcoin I have on Coinbase. So I'll never get those dividends. Unless I go join a lawsuit to make Bitcoin release the benefits that came. If somebody holds a piece of stock and there's a dividend,
you
they owe you
the
dividend.
The AOL or the Gmail?
They don't, they're not enforcing that.
Okay.
At Coinbase.
One of the biggest reasons not to have funds at an exchange for any lengthy period of time, maybe 15 minutes while they're trading or so, is that they can get hacked. And
I have had that happen a lot of times, and I've lost many thousands of dollars. So this, that's why I'm focusing on the local wallet. So go ahead.
Yeah. Just anecdotal, I guess I'm the anecdoter here. I lost about $3.5 million to non-docs when I got hacked.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like there's no recourse, there's nothing, and they just disappear without a trace unless you're like really on point. Now, I knew this to be true, like don't keep money in exchange, but I was just about to cash out, so I had to send it to them. And then they go, oh, we need your ID verified by the public notary. So I did that, I sent that, and I left it on the exchange while that was in the mail, and that's when it got hacked.
How long is it?
About a week or something.
When you speak, please speak loudly because the microphones are not close to you. So.
Right.
All right.
I have a follow-up question.
Loudly, or have to get the microphone in front of you.
My follow-up question is, you've now mentioned three kinds of wallets. Okay, supposedly the paper wallet, the hard wallet, and it's my question is about the third kind, which is where in the hell is that wallet? Is it online that it can be hacked, or is it just another name for an account somewhere, or what?
The wallet that we have here now.
The jack.
For example.
Yeah,
okay.
That is on Ralph's system and only on his system. So if he closes the lid to his computer, that wallet then in effect is inaccessible until he powers up his computer again. Now, with regard to the paper wallet, let's talk about that. Hey Lance.
Yep.
I thought I had this set up so that send works and it's not working. You probably know as much about wallets as I do, so while I talk about paper wallets, see if we can get that sent to that.
Okay.
Maybe that isn't right.
I got it.
Just make sure.
Okay.
Let me come over here. This is a Trezor hardware wallet.
Great. That's great.
So this plugs in as a USB to either a telephone or to a computer. So this is a wallet as well. So when it's disconnected, this is where it is.
Okay.
And you buy a Trezor wallet on Amazon?
I'm boycotting Amazon. I go to Trezor.io and they would only sell me a wallet if I had a Bitcoin. So I bought my Bitcoin on Coinbase, I shipped it to Trezor, and they shipped me this.
And that wallet costs an entire Bitcoin?
It doesn't work.
No,
a Litecoin.
No, this is roughly $70 in US dollars. So I don't remember what fraction of a Bitcoin that was.
And could you please spell Trezor and speak loudly?
Trezor.io.
Okay. Is that a T or a G?
T is the top.
Okay.
There. I'm just going to send 24,000. Okay. You have some leftover. Who cares?
All right. Okay. Let's see if that works. So with regard to answering Leigh's question, Ralph, let me show you wallet screen again. And I'll show you how that then. Okay, so it's a little hard to see right now. Okay, so click on that little hamburger there.
Okay.
Click again. There we go. Okay. Tools are setting. Let's try tools first. Okay. Backup wallet. Okay. View your backup phase. Okay. So you can't read that warning there, but Ralph, go ahead and read the warning for everybody's benefit.
Okay. It reads, the 12-word backup phrase will be displayed as both a QR code and a string of random words. Make sure you view your backup phrase in private. Anyone with the following QR code and the backup phrase can gain full access to your funds, so do not store them publicly or share them with anyone. I'm not going to do that!
Go ahead and press I understand. We will see the 12 words. There's nothing in your wallet right now, Ralph, and I think...
I'd rather...
Okay,
I'm going to ship that over somewhere, so... where this is not visible to our audience. So I'm going to press I understand. It's
okay.
You're not seeing that on the screen.
Okay.
What's coming up is a QR code.
And?
And a whole bunch of words underneath.
Okay, those are 12 random words, okay?
Or is it 24?
It is 12.
So Trezor has 24.
So those 12 words, Ralph, you write them on a piece of paper, you put the piece of paper in the time capsule, buried under your oak tree, and you now have an absolute cold storage, like you just buried a treasure chest of gold.
Okay. So I'm going to So Marty, can you read that? So I will read out loud what those were. No, I'm not.
Good choice. But so Larry, does that give you a little more perspective on how this works?
No.
Okay. What's missing?
First of all, how do I get a wallet, quote unquote? What's the difference between a wallet and an account somewhere?
In the world of cryptocurrency, wallet and account are synonymous.
I got a differentiation.
So,
okay, you could say it's like having cash or having the money in a bank.
Okay.
The bank could be robbed, but if you have the cash, you can stash it wherever you want it. And nobody can really see what you're doing.
They can rob
that
you.
One.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
If you open a Coinbase account, as I did, I don't remember creating a wallet per se, but I do have wallets for
you
Litecoin
have an
and all that.
You have an account at Coinbase, and they manage your wallets.
Okay, so it's like they created the wallet without my having to say explicitly I wanted to create a wallet.
Right. You're basically paying them for that service.
It's their wallet. With your name on it.
So the 12 words go to them? Mm-hmm. Is what it is, right?
Well, the 12 words is a convenience.
You will never get the 12 words or...
When you're with somebody else.
Yeah.
In my case, 24 words for the Trezor. The hardware is 24. You will never get those 24 words from Coinbase.
Right.
They own
right.
the 24
the
words.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
Yes. But if Ralph deletes this wallet off of his system after he has the 12 words, he can still get money sent to that. But if he wants to take the money and do anything with it, the cryptocurrency actually, he would have to reconstitute the wallet by plugging in the 12 words, which the Jax wallet lets you do.
If I have multiple wallets, like a Jax wallet, you know, an Exodus wallet, or do I have multiple
accounts or
multiple
wallets,
words
yes.
and multiple everything?
Yes.
Yes.
So everything's segregated.
Yeah.
Per wallet.
Yeah.
So you would be able to move stuff back and forth.
And in fact, on the Trezor hardware wallet, you get the 24 words, and then you can have a 25th word, and you can have a completely different wallet for each 25th word that you choose. So even though I waived one wallet, each 25th word that I pick, I can have the effect of a whole nother wallet. So that one physical wallet, I've got, you know, one of them, I've got three different accounts underneath it.
Okay.
The one I use that doesn't have the 25th word is the one that if a robber comes and steals it, I will tell him that that's it. Here are the 24 words. You can have it. And there's no knowledge that there is a 25th word. So there's, you know, it's a tenth of a Bitcoin. That's too much. I thought it wasn't much when I did it. But again, I did make that a little lighter now. So it's enough stuff so they can steal it and they think they got it.
Is the order of these 12 words or 24 words important?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. So, yeah, you need to keep them in that order. And in case somebody's wondering whether 12 words is enough, I haven't done the actual math, but I'm pretty confident that the odds of somebody else figuring out what those words are is as small as there's probably more atoms in the universe than there are. In other words, with 12 words, you can have a combination that is basically unguessable in the lifetime of the universe kind of thing.
Okay. So what's next?
I was trying to send you some dog coin, and for some reason my wallet's not letting me send that to your wallet, because that was going to be the final step of actually doing the transfer. And I'm not sure why that isn't happening, because we do have your Bitcoin address. Lance, any thoughts on that?
No, I don't get it. I've never used this wallet.
Okay.
How are you connected to the internet with your wallet?
Actually, I do have another wallet here as well. I'm just connected over Wi-Fi.
Well, the Corelli's Wi-Fi is really weak. If you go stand over there next to the curtains, it comes in much better.
Okay.
You're on Corelli's.
Let me actually try.
That's why you see me standing over there every once in a while. Just to get connected.
I like the breeze.
Yeah. Once you're connected, you can come back here and use it.
I thought you were wiping your mouth on the first.
I didn't think anybody saw that.
You were wrong.
Okay.
Okay, so you get 12 words that are randomly generated. What stops another wallet from randomly generating the same 12 words?
The chance of that happening, probably our sun will burn down long before that possibility could actually exist, and probably our whole galaxy will burn down before that possibility could come into existence.
But it literally could happen just right in a row. Like,
yes.
it's random. So
yeah,
it is
random. It's just that there's so many different possibilities. The odds are like that.
But there's so many billions of wallets, like, and ever more.
That's not a trivial objection. There's some reason they moved to 24 words.
Correct.
And I'm not sure how many words are in the space. Is it a 10,000 word space? How many words did they choose from?
I think that's probably about 10,000 to take.
Or maybe not 10,000.
10,000 to the.
Not even 10,000 words. It's less than that.
Why is it less?
Because nobody's vocabulary is 10,000 words.
It doesn't matter. It's a dictionary. And I've looked at a dictionary.
But, you know, all the words look familiar to me, and you know, they weren't words that I'd never seen before, so they're in my vocabulary.
Yeah, I'm not sure whether it's 5,000 or 10,000 words or whatever the. But by the time you take the 12th or the 24th power, like I said, the odds are vanishingly small that somebody else would have the same wallet, or that somebody would be able to guess your wallet based on that seed. Those words, you can have wallets without having those words. It's just that for the purpose of being able to do cold storage, it's a convenient way to have a wallet, what is called a seed.
You mentioned cold storage.
That's when you take those 12 words and you bury them under the oak tree, or under your mattress.
More background, please.
Okay, those 12 words you just saw.
Yes.
Okay. Let's say she wrote them down.
Yes.
Okay. Then you put them under your mattress.
Okay.
Okay. Then you go in there and you delete the wallet.
Uh huh.
Okay. Now it's in cold storage.
Okay.
So
now,
the government can go and go to where you got the 12 words and discover the 12 words, right?
Yeah, well, that's why you hide it on an oak tree.
Not where you got the words, but where your actual words are. If they find your words, they have your money, basically.
Of course, yes.
So if you have, you might want to store it in like half snippets here and there, even so.
Yeah, well, what I'm saying is I bury it under the tree, but the one who gave it to me stored it off somewhere else.
You should never be given words. You should have them generated on the fly by you,
but
do the generation.
But
Jax gives you the words.
Yeah, he's legitimate. That's a legitimate complaint. If Jax was, if his computer was hacked, or if Jax wasn't honest, they just gave Ralph the words.
And they kept.
And they could have shipped them off to Microsoft, or maybe Microsoft's got a spy running on his computer that keeps these things going, because there's back doors and all this stuff. So yeah, there's no
there's two things that can mess you up is lack of integrity on the person that gave you the words, or bad randomness. There's a world of people say that they generate these words randomly, and you say, well,
always
well what do you mean by that? And the answer to what is random is not trivial. There's a whole search of math to how do you get good random numbers.
Yes.
And as it's not a good random number, there's not a real assurance that those numbers are coming up randomly out of the space.
All of this is public key cryptography, right?
Very close.
Very yes. close, but it isn't that. Okay.
A lot of it is.
I'm going to ask a question. I think that's kind of wrong. So I've created something on Jax. This is Jax a Bitcoin exchange where money can be lost, or am I guaranteed that if I've got some number of Bitcoins in Jax, or I don't even know if I'm saying things correctly, that this is secure, absolutely secure, and this is a different question than Larry's. Larry wants to know, you've been handed these 12 random words, and those random words can be stolen by a third party. Let's assume those 12 random words are totally secure.
Yes.
Okay. If now that I have those 12 words and I have something on Jax, and I'm not sure what that something is that an account? Is that a?
It's a wallet.
It's a wallet.
Yes.
Now that wallet.
It's a metaphor.
It's a metaphor for a wallet. Somebody's saying.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's just a program on your computer.
It's a program on my computer. All but it's absolutely nobody else has my wallet.
Correct. Yes, and the idea that somebody should give you the 12 words, that's not how the way cryptocurrency works. You can give somebody your wallet address, your public address, and that is how things get transferred back and forth. But those 12 words are just as a backup in case your hard disk crashes in the next few seconds, for example.
Okay. On the screen, okay, there's a QR code.
Yes.
Okay. If people have that QR code, can they get into my wallet?
No. They can send you stuff.
Okay.
They can send you whatever they could
be.
No, it's just an address.
So this is the public key.
If I know where Ralph lives, I can visit him. If I have that, I can send him money.
Right.
The same thing.
Okay. So I'm perfectly safe leaving this up.
Yes.
Okay. Because this is going to be put up on YouTube.
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe somebody will send you money.
Yeah. In which case, I'm not perfectly safe.
I made a video. It was called, it's a how-to video just last week, and I put my address up for a different coin. It's fine. Yeah.
Okay.
It's all over YouTube.
All right.
Okay, I got one more.
Yes.
If you, you've got something in your wallet now, metaphorically or otherwise.
Okay? Yeah.
And can I transfer the contents to somebody else's wallet without being online?
No, you do need to have internet access in order to do a transfer. If you're offline, your wallet is safe in the sense that nobody can take anything out of it. But of course, nobody can put into it. Well, that's not true. If somebody has your wallet address, they can send things, but you just want to receive the message when you're offline that you were sent some cryptocurrency until you go back online.
No, it's really sitting online.
You want to be online.
It's
in the blockchain.
No, it's not sitting online. Yes. Well,
the fact that that address has that value associated with it is online. In fact, that's the genius of Bitcoin. It's not just online. It's online in 50,000 different places.
Good answer.
So the amount of money you have or that address controls is public information
it's known around the world.
Now that is for Bitcoin. There's other cryptocurrencies, Zcash, Monero, where that is, where that's not obvious. Although they all have a blockchain associated with them. The blockchain is done in such a way that you can't figure out whose cryptocurrency belongs to which account using Zcash and Monero, if I'm right. So that's
I need to study that.
Is there anybody here who is a Monero expert?
I will be in a couple of months.
Okay. Then at that point, we're going to do, with your permission, Bill, a Monero presentation. Are you up for that?
No comment.
Okay. We'll leave you anonymous.
Ralph, could you show your address again, because I do have a second wallet, a Dogecoin wallet. Okay, let me ask you, does it start with, because I can't see it up on the screen real well, does it start with capital D, capital S, small f?
Yes.
Does it end with 16 small z?
Yes.
Okay, I have no idea why I can't say this right now.
Perhaps because the network is loaded and it takes time?
No, it's the send. Oh, I see. It has to finish synchronizing. Okay.
This is online.
Okay. Well, it could be just as you pointed out, it is kind of slow.
If you're syncing the entire blockchain history on your laptop right there, that could take a long time.
Okay. That might be why I'm.
Well, it's only 2 years ago. A year ago, the length of the blockchain, which was about 6 gigabytes, I suspect it's double that by now, at least double that. So downloading 12 gigabytes of data will take a long time, especially on the networking Corellis.
The size of the Doge blockchain is probably much smaller.
Yeah. Yes. Still,
there's a blockchain for each coin that's separate.
Okay. That is a that is something I didn't know. So,
or a hash grid,
so that raises the question, if there is a, and let me get a different screen up so that we're not boring our viewers.
Faces.
Since there's a different blockchain for Doge as there is for Bitcoin, did I understand that correctly?
Correct, yes.
Okay, so if the Doge blockchain is somehow cracked, the Bitcoin blockchain might still be secure. I don't know what encryption method Doge uses. Do you know if it's elliptical? Do you know if it's just RSA cryptography? Do you have any clue?
No. Different cryptocurrencies, as you implied, do have different encryption algorithms, and that's part of why there's so many different cryptocurrencies, because everybody's trying to figure out the sweet spot of various factors, and each currency has its own unique blockchain and its own unique algorithm.
So Doge is, if I have some number of Doge somethings, okay, I don't know if they're coins or whatever, that's completely different than having it in Bitcoin, is that correct?
Yes.
All right, so Doge is a form of cryptocurrency. It's not that Bitcoin is being stored in Doge.
No, yeah.
I'm seeing a yes, I'm seeing.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay, so
the reason we can't do the transaction now is because he's downloading all the transactions that ever happened on Dogecoin onto his computer. So, so his computer knows that all the balances. But there are so-called light wallets as well, which only just download a tiny little bit, so you don't have to download all the transaction history, the entire ledger, and that makes for a quick synchronization, as it were, and then you can get it up and running faster.
Well, I'm not sure that's actually what's happening here, in that it's it's downloading the entire blockchain. Because last night I was able to transfer from two different wallet accounts. I'm pointing at my screen here because I have two different wallets, and it happened pretty quickly. So I don't have a good explanation on why. It was working perfectly well for me last night. Well, actually, I do have a good explanation. It's just that when you try to demonstrate things, nothing seems to work right.
But you know what, Mike? Why don't you do what Bill suggests? Why don't you simply walk near the entrance so that you can get a stronger signal to your laptop, and we'll spend a few minutes on that.
It says the signal is fine.
Yeah, it's not that.
Well, that's the problem. I've had this problem before, which is why I'm hardwired in. It says that the signal is wonderful here. Uh-huh. It doesn't work.
I see.
So,
okay.
Yeah, so let's just give it a shot for 2-3 minutes. Okay, Steve.
I got another question about these words and things. So the words are generated randomly, and then once you get like a Bitcoin shipped to those words, the words then go onto the blockchain, right?
Those words should never leave the oak tree.
Sure, okay, but then you dig them up and you go over to your wallet app and you put the words in. That's how you access the contents of the wallet.
No.
How do you access the contents of the wallet?
You simply pull it up on your computer like I have right here,
and
then you automatically get to the content. The words are stored on the hard disk.
Right, but if this is wiped and then you bury a piece of paper,
yes,
and then you have words on a piece of
paper.
Oh
yeah,
and you take those words, you put them into a thing, and the thing says, oh, that connects to this wallet on the blockchain that holds whatever, one Bitcoin.
No.
Right?
It's not a wallet on the blockchain. Yeah.
It's just an address on the, word?
It's just a ledger. It's a password for an account.
The blockchain is a ledger,
okay.
Is what it is.
So how does the blockchain know that my words get? The words themselves aren't stored on the blockchain.
Steve,
how
can I ask you to
words,
move the microphone closer so that
how
people
do those, can... How do those words access that line on the blockchain? Unless the blockchain knows the words.
Okay, so you dig up the words from Oak Tree. In the wallet app, it's like restore a wallet from a seed. That's an option. You put those words in, and it'll know what the address is that it recreates. So that address is what is.
So you have to use the same app then. To get those words?
Not necessarily. I believe the algorithm, I haven't tested this, but those words probably can be shared among a number of different wallets.
It's a standard.
So it is a standard.
If you got
yes.
those words and you go from Jax to somebody else,
Electrum
that, uses,
or mycelium,
12, that
yeah.
uses the 12 words, you can get back. And you don't just get back your current contents, you get all of the history of all your transactions.
Yes, they will show you that history as when you put in the words, it'll go to the blockchain and it'll have the complete history of all the transactions that were done in that particular wallet or account.
Okay, so then who knows the words? You're saying the blockchain doesn't store the words, and any given
well,
wallet,
that's part of
but the words are access points, so it has to match on both sides.
No, the words generate a number, the hash of the number generates the history.
Okay.
So part of the beauty of the hashing algorithms is you don't go from the results of the hash, you can't tell what the source of the hash was.
Correct.
The 12 words give you the source of the hash.
Okay.
It's a one way.
So it goes one way.
It's a one way hash.
Exactly. Yes. Right, and that is part of what the whole cryptography thing is that you using the 12 words, yes, you can get the address which determines what the account is and the history on the blockchain. But if knowing those, you cannot get back.
You can't get the words.
And specifically, actually, if you want to delve into a little bit more detail, the words that Belf sent in an email to me, excuse me, that the address, that's what is known as a public key. If you're familiar with cryptography, you've heard of public key and private keys. The 12 words create the private key.
Gotcha.
Okay, that makes sense now?
Yeah, thanks.
All right, so...
That's
so what's happening on your computer, Mike?
It's still... Because for some reason I'm starting to wonder if the address isn't right or something, because I'm still not able to transfer it. But in, you know, I was actually here a couple of weeks ago and we did a transfer of Bitcoin from one wallet to another, so I hope it works around here, but it's not working for me today.
Okay, so be that as it may, assume that let me get this up on the screen. So let's just assume that 0.0 changes to something else.
Yes, because I sent you some Dogecoin or Dogecoin or whatever.
Right. And then what can I do with it?
There you go. Feel proud?
Well, with Dogecoin, it is sometimes used for tips, to tip somebody else. And so you can send it to somebody, send those to somebody else in their wallet, and then that can be translated to back into some other cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, or it can be turned back into cash. That you can take it on exchange, and I guess maybe that's where we should go next, is talking about trading and speculating.
Well, okay, let's go and do that.
Okay,
so let's assume that if I had one Dogecoin right now.
Yes.
How much would that be worth in USD?
Slightly under a penny.
Okay.
You can risk that, right?
Maybe.
No.
Okay. Go ahead, Mike. Where do you want me to go?
Okay. So, let me see. There are a number of...
Are we talking about trading?
Yes.
Go to Binance.com.
Okay, go ahead, Lance.
Binance.com.
Binance.com. Okay, and I'll put that up on the screen in a moment.
Okay.
Binance.
Yep. So I like this one. B. So I used Bittrex for a while, but then after the circles that I run in online, you know, they just recommend it over and over and over again. Get away from it. Sure enough, then my wife got hacked. So we got off that one.
Could I stop you for a second? How did your wife get hacked?
She got phished through an email. That came across, came up on her personal email, and it looked like it was from Bittrex, but it was not. And so I've been slowly having to teach her, hey, here's how you don't get hacked.
So the act of her just opening it is how she got
it? No. So phishing, the idea behind phishing is, now we're getting off tangent, but the idea behind phishing is that a very similar looking email that you, like, let's say it's from Wells Fargo, it'd be like, customer support at Wells Fargo, 9874357.com. Like, there's always a telltale sign about how it's kind of phishing.
Yeah.
Instead of just support at wellsfargo.com, right? So she got that kind of an email.
Right.
So be suspicious of something like that.
Right.
The only time I found that any of these exchanges email you is if you are making a transaction, because they want to do at least two-step verification, and usually it's three at this point. Okay, so. I switched over to this one. It's great. You can get almost any coin. Well, you can get probably 75% of the coins out there right now, and I think there's what, over 1,000 at this point. So it's.
Could you stop that? There are 1,000 competitors to Bitcoin. Is that what
yeah.
you just said?
Is that about right, Bill?
Oh yeah.
About 1,000,
probably.
You
more.
Would know too. What's your name, sir?
Magnus.
Magnus. Magnus would
probably more.
Yeah. Probably
lots
more.
I'll get you the number here in a second.
Yeah. So, your first step, if you want to get into this and start trading it, is you're going to have to take the plunge and either do a Kraken account or a Coinbase account, it was already mentioned, or
you're going to start mining like I do, right? And then you're just completely semi off the grid. Then from there, once you purchase, let's say, one of the four cryptocurrencies on Coinbase, then you need to set up an account at Binance and or a different trading platform. Personally, I like this one the best. It's worked out well. There hasn't been any fraud. Everybody that I run with seems like it's okay. It's a very similar setup to Coinbase in that you have to take a silly picture of yourself with your camera on and stuff like that, and you have to show it. In this case, it's your passport or a driver's license, the date. It's a very arduous process, but once you do get approved, then trading is really simple. And they don't have an iPhone app, but they do have an Android app. So I have a lot of friends who are tech geeks and super bored at their work all day long, and they actually day trade, and they do pretty well. Go ahead.
1,378.
There you go. And growing, right?
And
there's probably another one.
Maybe tomorrow.
Yeah.
And is there a...
Well,
you know what?
Beautiful question.
Yes. Let me ask. Your question comes next, Marty. My question is there a market in all these, you know, can you buy a bundle of all these exchanges?
A basket of cryptocurrencies?
A basket of cryptocurrencies. Thank you.
Yeah, if you're going to speculate, it probably should be a basket.
Isn't Ron Paul advocating now like a crypto backed IRA where you can bundle them? I'm pretty sure if you go to Ron Paul, RonPaulLibertyReport.com, I swear to God he's doing that now. So, yes.
Well,
someone's already doing that.
I'm not sure it's up and running yet where you can buy a basket, but yes. I'm sure
he's doing some kind of package.
There are proposed ETFs that are supposed to be representative of a basket of cryptocurrencies.
Yeah.
Whether they will remain solvent or not, I don't know. But there are proposals into the SEC, and this is back in the world of conventional finance.
If you're willing to invest in a crypto that has a bundle of cryptos under it, I think there's a project called Prism that does that.
Okay, so let's go to Marty's question. Marty, say it again loudly, because the microphone's all the way over there.
I see you kind of answered it. She said you have to research. My question was, how do you know what to invest in? Which one to invest in?
So, okay, let's repeat that question. How do you know which one to invest
in?
Yeah,
so the question was, how do you know out of these 1,330 and climbing cryptos to invest in? My personal take on that is, when I do research on a coin, it has to have some kind of utility. So number one, it has to it solves a different problem. So, you know, Bitcoin is just at this point a big mammoth of storing wealth. Because it takes so long to do transactions, and it's valued so high, it's more of just I'm just going to put, you know, throw 20,000 fiats at it, U.S. dollars, and let it sit and accumulate.
But what about Bitcoin Cash?
Okay, so then Bitcoin Cash forked off of Bitcoin with the idea that now we're going to solve the problem that Bitcoin had, where it's taking transactions hours, sometimes up to a day or two, plus a $30 fee on each transaction, like Mike mentioned. And Bitcoin Cash is going to solve that problem by making it lightning fast and very, very small fractional fees. So you could say, okay, I believe in Bitcoin Cash now, and I'm going to buy one Bitcoin Cash because I feel like it's going to be more widely accepted than Bitcoin. That'd be maybe one reason why, right? I'll speak to another coin. So there's another coin that I really like that I'm invested in, and it's called Ripple, right? I like to call it the status coin, though. So as a libertarian, it's, you know, kind of... Fundamentally, it isn't a full line of my philosophy because it's not a decentralized coin, but its speeds are, I think it takes, the last time they recorded it was like 2 seconds across international waters it took to transfer stuff. And it's very small fees to do those kind of transfers. The other indicator that I really liked is that Amex last month came out and they said, we're going to start using it. And then 2 weeks ago,
Ripple.
XRP. Okay. 2 weeks ago, South Korea and Japan said they're going to start doing tests back and forth. And then the third indicator, if you're trying to make money off of this, okay, you're really trying to, if this is like your version of gambling or stock market stuff, right? The third indicator is there's a lot of rumors swirling that Ripple will be added to Coinbase. And so why that matters is when Bitcoin Cash got added to Coinbase, It inflated by, it doubled after it finally went back down. But in one day, it inflated, I think, four or five times, went up to almost 10K.
Okay.
And then there was like accusations of insider trading and stuff, but it has to have like three of those things. There has to be this indicator that is some corporations are going to accept it. Number two, there's some kind of utility, like it solves some problem.
Right.
And number three, it's going to get put on an exchange that's more widely prevalent. I think those are the basic indicators.
Lance?
I'm going to stop you guys. I need to stop recording for 30 seconds so that the computer catches up, and then we'll start again. We are now recording. And Heidi, please repeat that question.
Yeah, how do we get the news about a new coin such as Ripple being added to Coinbase Exchange?
You follow as many people.
Will you tell us?
Related to Coinbase and their employees on Twitter as you can. You try to join as many social media groups, and you just try to figure out which rumors are really true or not. That is about it. I really don't have a good indicator because they don't. Because if they announce tomorrow that Ripple is going to get put
right
on, the buying frenzy,
sure
you know, and then you got to question like insider trading and pump and dumps. I mean, that's one of the big problems with cryptocurrencies,
yeah,
is pump and dumps. So
yeah, okay.
To continue where what Lance alluded to is that just like in trading stocks or futures or anything else where you're speculating, there are different philosophies and different approaches. What Lance just outlined is a particularly common sense approach, but it really is the wild world with cryptocurrencies right now, the Wild West with cryptocurrencies right now, because there's, unlike something that's regulated, like stocks, there is no such thing as insider trading in cryptocurrencies because there is no insiders or outsiders. It is just still very much the Wild West. So with regard to how you speculate with cryptocurrencies is that there are a lot of different approaches, but I should caution everybody that just like with stocks or options or futures, most people end up losing money. Now, cryptocurrencies are a little bit unusual in that it's a really strong case of a rising tide raises all ships.
Yeah.
And so it's a lot of people are just, there's a lot of success stories just because a lot of people have invested in it. And really, it's as much luck as anything that they happen to be at the right place at the right time in investing in cryptocurrencies and whatever. With regard to making money on it, there are a lot of different approaches. There's people I know that day traded or swing traded just on technical indicators. Lance has more of what is called a fundamental approach, if you're familiar with that kind of philosophy with regard to trading stocks and such. So, one other difference between that and stocks is with stocks, you have a certain amount of public information, you have price earnings ratios, you have a lot of traditional metrics.
Right.
On that you can base your decisions on. With the cryptocurrencies, it's still very much the Wild West in that, for example, there's no such equivalent of a price-earning ratio or anything at all like that. So there's a much wider range of possible ways that you could make money or lose money because it's, like I said, just such a whole new field. One other thing I want to say with regard to trading, one of the reasons that Bitcoin had such a strong rise is it was initially rumored and it was true that Chicago Mercantile Exchange and another one of the big exchanges, Cboe, I believe, now that you trade futures, and that should actually help stabilize the price, but it also caused an increase in demand in the last few months, which is one of the reasons that Bitcoin, and therefore all cryptocurrencies, tend to rise if Bitcoin rises to some extent, not necessarily always, but there is at least a trend. So now institutional investors have an ability through the futures market to invest in Bitcoin and probably eventually other cryptocurrencies, and that has legitimized the whole field a whole lot. And potentially adds more stability, There'll be a certain amount of, obviously there's regulations with any futures, so you know there's going to be a certain amount of regulations as well. It's like I said, it's very much a wild west, and aside from getting potentially hacked, there's pump and dumps. There's people, you know, putting in false rumors just because. Actually, with Bitcoin, the main Reddit forum for Bitcoin is strongly controlled and monitored very strongly. So it's a crazy world, not for the faint of heart, for sure.
Okay.
Okay. Who's talking? Who wants to be recognized?
We're done.
Okay. Lance, you're up again. Please talk to us about this.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, go to Exchange right here. And then just click on Basic. So they sort of, what's nice about them is they allow you to see what it would be like if you were actually logged in to your account and trading. Hopefully it just rolls up here. And you can search for, even before you jumped in, let's say you found some coin by some person, you know, I don't know, that just interests you and you want to trade for it. You can search for it on here. There we go. So, can you move the screen?
Yeah, I'm gonna try.
Who's BNB?
I have no idea. That's like their own little coin they have. And if you buy it, then you can get your trades are much cheaper. Here we go. Yeah, so then on the, can you move over to the right side?
Can you slide?
Yeah. So then here's where you should be able to search for all of the different currencies that trade with whatever, all the trading partners, right? So like this one is Cardano, ADA, BTC, Bitcoin, BAT, Ethereum, all those sorts of things. And then down here, go down here once, bro.
What am I looking?
Make the screen go up.
Okay.
So here's where you can trade. You know, let's say you were trying to buy some of their currency that they have on their own exchange. Then you can put in, you know, if you're trying to, how much you want to exchange for, right? The tricky part, I think, is always trying to how you convert everything, because it's like, it's this weird three-way thing between, we just can't think of anything else other than what it costs in USD. And so then there's this, what's it USD, what's BTC, you know, Bitcoin, and then what is the other thing you're trading for, to try to figure it all out, so.
That's interesting. I'm looking at buy BNB and sell BNB, and the price is exactly the same, so there's no spread.
I don't know what that one is. Go to BTC instead, Ralph. So go all the way up again, move the whole thing. I don't know what, I've never done the BNB thing.
Can you click on USDT?
Awesome. So now we'll now go to the BTC to USD. So let's say you were trading
BTC US. Is that,
yep.
Am I at the right place?
Yep. Click on that.
And am I understanding?
Now scroll down. Now let's pull this up, Rob.
Yeah, but am I understanding from this where I'm circling?
Yeah.
That today's price in Bitcoin in US dollars is 13,700.
Yes.
So it dropped from 18,000 to 13,700 in the span of roughly a week?
3 weeks? 2 weeks?
Yeah.
2 weeks? Yeah. Yes, Ralph.
Okay. Sounds like the things I invest in. Okay, so now what are we doing?
So that's it. So I just wanted to say, if you... this is the one I recommend. There's a bunch of other ones too, though.
Well, Bitfinex is... Some former Soviet bloc country that it's out of.
Estonia?
Yeah. Anyway, from that one, if you have a non-US IP address, you don't have to give any identifiable information at all, and I've done so. And you can trade without having to have the know your customer laws, if you happen to be outside the United States, or at least appear to be so.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. And what is this 25%, 50%, 75%, 100% down there?
So let's say you had one Bitcoin, or you had
you had $13,749.97 USD on this exchange. If you were saying, okay, I want to buy some BTC, I want to spend 25% of that, 50%, 75%, 100%.
Or some other amount. So I could say I want to spend $1,000.
You could put in, you would put in like point, let's say you just want to do 0.5 Bitcoin, right? So then it would be half of that USD.
So the amount is in
BTC.
Yep. Is in Bitcoin.
Yep.
So
0.5 or something. Put that in there.
Oh, my God, it's slow.
Yeah.
Come on. Max amount zero. That's probably because I have no Bitcoin.
And one tip I would give, if anybody's serious about day trading, I am not a day trader. I have too many things going on, and I would lose my butt. So I just hog. But if you are trying to day trade on this, I would recommend either buying Litecoin, Ethereum, Ethereum number one. Ethereum first, then maybe Litecoin, and then maybe Bitcoin Cash. Sending that over, then trading up for BTC, then trading for whatever coin you need. Because if you send Bitcoin, it's going to cost you $30. Oh, it's just like not worth it. Ethereum, I sent one last night. I bought Kyler some stuff. I sent Ethereum over, and I think I spent like $2 or something to send it. It was very cheap compared to Bitcoin.
Uh-huh.
And then it's much quicker too. Bitcoin, like at the height of when we were at 18K, there were so many transactions, there was like 250,000 transactions backed up waiting to happen. And it was taking 12 to 24 hours to just transfer. So if you're trying to get in on it, you know, like a coin is diving by 30%, and you're like, well, I know the Fibonacci sequence is saying it's going to come back up. It's going to come back up, and I need to trade quickly. Do not use Bitcoin for that. Try Ethereum or something else.
Mm-hmm.
Please explain more about Ethereum. What is Ethereum?
So, I would be out of water there. I'll try to have a 40,000 foot perspective, okay? So, when the question came up, why would another coin besides Bitcoin, why would I want to invest in it? Well, there you go. Ethereum just proved its utility by being able to be so quick and have a very low transaction fee, and therefore more widely used. You're going to say something.
It's a world computer. You can host smart contracts on there.
Yes.
And program your money to do things when things happen. I'm a community manager for a company called Digits. We tokenize gold on the blockchain, which means that you have one of these tokens that rides under this on the Ethereum blockchain. That means you own a gram of gold, and you can transfer that and have it be like as. It just goes to show that you could do a lot more than just send value back and forth. You can send different kinds of things. There's even a game that's out called CryptoKitties.
Oh my God! Yeah, pull that up, bro.
Where they?
It's hilarious.
And they breed cats on blockchain and try to make that fun game. So, yeah,
well,
here's devolving.
Here's why that's so interesting. Okay. Since I've had, you know, my kids are like teenagers now, young teenagers. I've always said this. If I could ever get ahead of the game on any of these dang Pokemons, Bakugans, all these things that come out of Southeast Asia,
mm-hmm.
that just explode in the U.S. like a year or two later,
uh-huh.
when they were forced to pay all this stuff because the kids want them and it's Christmas and all. You are going to, if you have kids, if you haven't had kids yet, or you are going to, I guarantee, at some point in America, there's going to be this big scream for, Dad, I need Ethereum! Mom, I need Ethereum! Like, they're going to be asking for some cryptocurrency, and that's going to be a weird way that it starts to get adopted too. Because you have to buy this Ethereum in order to make the kitty, to breed them, right? Sorry, Magnus. To breed them, right? You have to buy it to breed them, and then I think you have to, and then you can also sell your kitties for it. So again, it's just like
I need to have the right spelling for CryptoKitties.
CryptoKitties.
Remove the .com. You'll get it.
Say again?
Remove the .com and just see what you get. Might be a space between.
It is CryptoKitties, the way you spelled it, .co. There's no .com.
Yeah.
just .co.
It's just intangible. Yep.
Click on that.
I've got it up on my phone. Anyway, so this was like the first app that they started in running on Ethereum coin. Or network or whatever, because you have to run Ether. I don't understand how it honestly works. But the point is like, this is what I'm talking about with soon that people are going to, parents are going to have to be buying this stuff. Just so they can fund these stupid apps for these kids. And people are going to get rich. So you might as well get in on the, you know, and own some of the coin while it's low.
Okay, question? We stand.
Who, me?
Yeah, whoever has the
name. Which cryptocurrencies are you people in the group most bullish on? Which
Ripple. Ripple.
And what else?
The status coin. It's already accepted by these major banks. Watch and wait till it gets on. I think it's going to go on Coinbase next month, and it's going to explode.
Wow.
It's going to explode. So I won't say how much I own, but I bought in when it was at 25 cents a share, and right now I think it's at $1.
A coin.
Coin. Sorry, you're right. A coin, and now it's at $1.30. So and it's at the $1.30. And one of the only few green ones right now. In other words, everything else is just plummeting.
So,
so we go to Binance.
Can we go to that website associated with Ripple?
Yeah, go to just ripple.com, I believe. Let me check. Let me check, Ralph. But that one's.
Wouldn't that be the liquor?
I don't know. Let me see. I'll help you out here, Ralph.
The way to find information about any of these coins.
Yes, it's just ripple.com.
Like if you start at CoinMarketCap,
we'll
you
do
get
that
a list.
Moment. Join Ripple Net.
And so the question about Ripple.
Yeah, that's it. And then you can learn all about it.
You can just click and learn about the coin.
What's really cool is they show, these guys in particular show the difference between.
Can I ask for science? Because we're being recorded.
One of the cool things they show is okay, here's how long it takes for a Bitcoin transaction, here's how long it takes for a Litecoin transaction, here's how long it takes for a Ripple transaction. And obviously, they're trying to sell, you know, themselves and stuff, but it is that fast and it does work that well. The other good thing about it is, if you decide to do cold storage, which you should, and you have a wallet like Bill had, I use Ledger S Nano, and you can store your Ripple on that too, and that it's one of the I think there's maybe only a dozen that you can put on that Ledger NS, but it's good.
Bill, could you say the name of that? And Larry, you'll be next. Bill, could you say the name of that website that you were?
CoinMarketCap.com, and I use that as my kind of overview, and you can get to all the 1300. Oh, by the way, it is now 1,379 cryptocurrencies. Earlier today, it was 1,378. And for the coins like Marcus was talking about, DigitDAO, those kind of markets where they built something on Ethereum or on what, EOS is the other one you can build things on. There's two coins that
you
can build stuff on. There's 7,400
stuff.
There's a whole nother, you've heard about ICOs, initial coin offerings. It's the replacement for initial public offerings, except for you don't have to have an SEC or a venture capitalist. You can go out and propose a business, and then you have to, and you can raise money for the business. You can't be it in stock, they don't own the business, but they can have tokens, which are participation tokens in your business. So when you purchase a DigitDAO coin
token,
it's a participation token. Is that also correctly for you?
I don't know.
It represents some piece of gold.
Yeah, it's like we partnership in the distributed autonomous organization. So which is basically, Digit's not a good example because it has even more complexity to governance.
Never mind.
So choose something else.
But there's some very simple ones, like the only one I'm in is an advertising deal where they say, we as a company are going to provide, if you want to advertise on Larry's website, then we will make that happen, and you don't have to have anybody else involved. You can go to the coin and put the money in here, and as Larry proves that he's had so many page views, he'll get payment for his website. So it's a way of doing advertising for materials without going through Google or Yahoo or Facebook.
Larry, could I ask you pick up the red microphone, and then you're next? And could I ask you to stand?
Okay, the...
Could I ask you to stand, Larry, so that you're on screen?
With or without the microphone? Okay, here, what has really confused me through all of this is I came in to hear about cryptocurrencies. Currency is something that I use as a medium of exchange by definition. Okay? And what I've heard that mostly was something else. Okay? I want to know how I can buy a currency, a cryptocurrency, presumably. Okay? That will substitute for U.S. dollars. I can do transactions with, I can go online and order something from other than Amazon, Bill, and not pay $30 a transaction for it, okay? Or $3 a transaction for it. Okay? Is there anything out there that does that? And if there is, how do we get into that?
We're not quite there yet.
I haven't spent a dime of it yet, so I have. I don't know. I do have a bunch of friends though that have claimed they've done multiple things, like they pay their a lot of their travel expenses. So you can. I think it's on Expedia now accepts Bitcoin for travel expenses.
Who?
Expedia.
Oh.
Yeah. And then Dish, you can pay your satellite payment with Bitcoin.
Overstock also.
Overstock, that's a big one. Yep, you could use that. But
at
again,
$30 a transaction.
Exactly, that's the issue. So it's not really a currency at this point. Especially Bitcoin. I mean, that's the idea behind Litecoin, is that. Or Litecoin or other ones that you should be able to start doing these transactions.
And the SHIFT credit card that I just showed you, that it's in my wallet, I'll bring it back out, that I paid for dinner with, because I have to use it every 6 months, is tied to my Coinbase account, and there was no $24 thing, because it's just like a bank, it's not your... So you can use that any place you use a debit card. So so the only settlement on the blockchain that has to happen with that card is when at the end of the day, the SHIFT credit card company and Coinbase settle up. So you don't get charged $25. So this is the start of off-chain transactions where you can keep a little bit of money or a little bit of Bitcoin in Coinbase, not so much because of all the other disadvantages, but that money is available for any place that will take a Visa debit card.
Yeah. Did I hear Roger Beer say that pretty soon there'll be a Visa debit card for
Bitcoin Cash? Bitcoin Cash. That was an announcement that they're in talks with Visa. Yep.
Right. So there's one here for Bitcoin right now. I've only bought one meal with it.
Leadership?
No, SHIFT.
No, he's you got everything gold for that guy.
I want to give you another option. I have here something called it's a Visa card by the company 10X, TENX.tech, TECH. Currently, they do Bitcoin transactions, but they're going to be adding more cryptos like Ethereum and Dash, Litecoin, and probably Bitcoin Cash, so you will have a bit later on these currencies that are cheap to spend and fast, so you can use it in a day-to-day, and this is accepted wherever Visa is accepted, and it's you prepay it, so you take some of your from your cold wallet or whatever, send it to an account that's connected to this, just how much you want there, and then you can spend that as just how you want. And there's an app where you can lock the card, you can lose it, and unlock it again if you find it. And
So if you want to avoid taxes and all, that's what my question is about that. If you go take your U.S. dollars, exchange them on Coinbase, and then, so you're in Bitcoin, you take all the Bitcoin and put it on a cold wallet, can you then take that cold wallet, prepay it to a credit card, and is that traced through taxes, or?
So when you just transfer from one wallet to another, that's not a taxable event.
Right.
So at the moment you spend it, that is...
But how do they know that you went and took that Bitcoin?
Right, so that's where the IRS is going to go after, whether it's processing your payment or doing the transaction from cryptocurrency to fiat. Because that conversion does happen, because this restaurant does not accept cryptocurrency per se, and they never know that this was paid for with this crypto. So they'll go for that, like the interface. All the on and off ramps where crypto and fiat are interfacing, that's where any checks will be made.
Yeah.
Bill is next, but I do have a question. As I understand it, if I want to send Bill some fraction of a Bitcoin, because I can't afford an entire one, that transaction has almost no fee associated with it, or am I right, or am I wrong with that?
It depends what currency you're using. Bitcoin, there's $25 or something right now.
Dogecoin, almost no fee.
Bitcoin Cash, next to nothing.
Litecoin, also next to nothing.
The relationship between Bitcoin Cash and Bitcoin?
That's a different, you've got a second question. Let me answer Brenda's first question.
Okay, go ahead.
So, the IRS knows what you did at Coinbase.
Yes.
So when you sent your Bitcoins out of Coinbase, or whatever you had at Coinbase, out to a wallet, they know what address it came from, they know what address it went to.
Yeah, what if they're stolen? I mean,
That's very good. So now they're stolen. And you tell the IRS they were stolen, and so it was the thief that spent them. But they still can keep track of where they went. So now they're in that address, and if they got stolen, they went to some other address.
Okay.
And they can keep following those, and if any of those addresses come back to benefit you, then they'll know maybe it wasn't really stolen, maybe you just said it was stolen.
Okay, so if I purchase in Bitcoin always and not have a purchase in USD?
And you want to be able to claim to them that it was stolen.
No, I'm saying
but
that
you
I
don't
want
to get
general.
Anything delivered to you. Right? Like, because they'll know that Bitcoin was spent at Overstock. See, the Bitcoins are still tracked. Just because they were stolen or not stolen doesn't matter. All the transactions, it
just
went from address 3 to 7 or 12, or it goes every address it went to,
yeah,
and every fraction it went to can be followed, and they have a whole team of programmers working the blockchain.
But that's just because of Coinbase, though? That's because they initiated everything?
You started there. Now, if you started with a miner, then you have a better chance at anonymity.
Right.
Or if you started with Monero, you have a better chance.
Or, as a matter of fact, if you bought some Bitcoin off the street. Yeah.
Whoa. buying Bitcoin off the street. What does that mean?
Give me $100 and I will give you Bitcoin.
Okay. that sounds like a very fair trade at $13,000.
Well, I'll give you an appropriate amount, or a Dogecoin, or Ethereum, or whatever.
Sure,
yes.
I need a change. That's just going to be 35 cents change, not much. But
okay.
So
does anybody else have any questions or any comments?
There's at least one person here that's requested we turn off the recording, and then anybody else that might want to have questions that do not want to get recorded will be able to do
so. That sounds fine. So I'm about to turn off recording.
unless your question is really, really interesting and you don't mind being recorded. But having heard nothing, I am going to now stop recording. But
okay,
before
now we can
I
really
stop recording, I think our three presenters deserve a huge round of applause.